1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17. Now, our screen right there is broke. So here's that day where the pastor say, you should have brought your Bible. Well, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17 says, pray without ceasing. It does work in the back. Scripture's on the wall in the back if you don't have your Bible. Pray without ceasing. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17 says, pray without ceasing. Please look at somebody and ask them, what are you praying about? Yeah, that's right. What are you praying about? I don't care if they knew. Ask them, what are you praying about? Glory to God. Hallelujah. For weeks, we have been talking about living life on another level. So when I begin to think about God giving me what we're speaking about today, I begin to think about how I was at the house and tried to get some things squared away for my daughter, and so I had to begin moving stuff up on the top shelf, right? Because I kind of ran out of room down there, so I had to put some stuff up on the top shelf. Anybody ever just put some important, you know how you put important stuff on the top shelf? You don't see it that much. You want to keep people out of it, and it's way up there. It's out of reach, right? So it's on the top shelf. But then I noticed when I had to go back, I had to go get a step stool because I had to get the step stool because I needed to reach up a little higher to get that what I stored that was important. I had to get my step stool to go a little higher. I want to talk today about retrieving stuff that's a little higher. You see, we're getting ready to retrieve some things that have been stored up for us a little higher. Some things we need, we're going to have to level up. Some things that we don't have that we need, we're going to have to level up. Some tools that we're going to have to use to apply to this life, we're going to have to level up to reach a little higher. One of the things we're going to absolutely need to do if we're going to live life on another level is pray. It's pray. If we're going to live life on another level, one of the things we absolutely must do is pray. Prayer is access. Prayer is a key to the room of God. Prayer is a key to the room of God. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 8, verse 1, that God shuts up heaven for 30 minutes every day so that he can hear the prayers of the saints. The Bible says he lifts an incense that represents the prayers of the saints, and it goes in the throne room of God. And God says heaven has to be quiet for 30 minutes. Do you understand what I'm talking about? God says that if you praying, I'm telling you, stop that holy, holy, holy right now. Shh, let me hear from him. He's praying to me. God says, shh, stop that holy, holy right now. I hear Amanda calling on me. You see, your prayers go up to the throne room of God. There's a key to the room of God, and it's in prayer. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your prayers access the throne room of God in such a way that it makes heaven be quiet for 30 minutes. Prayer is not just tucked away in your prayer closet. Prayer is a lifestyle. The Bible says that Adam communed and walked with God daily. It says he walked with God in the cool of the day. You see, Adam lost that. But then here comes the second Adam, Jesus, and he restored that communication, and it's called prayer. Prayer is communing with God. You cannot have an effective relationship with somebody if you don't communicate with them. Am I right about it, Ms. Birch? You cannot have an effective relationship with somebody if there is no communication. Prayer is how we exercise our closeness with God. Watch this. Prayer is direct, intimate conversation with God. Prayer is direct, intimate conversation with God. The same way air is critical to a human being living, Prayer is critical for Christians living. If a Christian is going to live without prayer, he's like a stillborn baby. I know y'all don't like to hear that, but if you're a Christian and you're living without prayer, you're like a stillborn baby. You're a baby, you're a child of the Most High God, but your life is really dead because there is no communication with God. In the old church I used to go to, my grandmama and them used to say, little prayer, little power. Much prayer, much power. Glory to God. You know, prayer was so important. Prayer was so important, Tony, that the disciples asked, God, would you teach us how to pray? That's how important prayer was. The disciples went to Jesus and said, Jesus, hey, prayer is so important. Teach us how to pray. Jesus says, no problem. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He says, give us this day our daily bread. He says, lead us not. Wait a minute. He says, forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. He says, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. That's what Jesus told him. That's what Jesus told him. Now, if you notice that when Jesus told them how to pray, it begins with praise. Hallowed be thy name. It begins with praise. Watch this. Watch this. It begins with praise and it ends with praise. Because the way Jesus taught him to pray, he says, hallowed be my name. That's praise. And then at the end of the prayer that Jesus taught him, he says, thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. You see, watch this. But everything in between the two praises was a petition. Petition means request. Here's the good news. Our Father wants us to ask. Our Father wants us to ask. Don't feel selfish about asking God for stuff. Don't feel selfish about asking God. But although God says ask, you need to remember that the quickest way to get your ask answered is to ask for somebody else. The Bible has given us a kingdom principle that sometimes we tuck under tithes and offering. The Bible says, give, and it shall be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Every time we read that scripture, they think a preacher's getting ready to beg for money. That's not a begging money scripture. That's a kingdom key. It's a kingdom key. It's a kingdom principle. Give much prayer, much prayer gets answered for you. Come on, somebody. Come on. I'm trying to help us today. So Jesus taught us to pray like this. Praise, petition, praise. Mm-hmm. In John 14, 15, and 16, this is Jesus, and he is in the upper room. It's the Last Supper. When you read John 14, John 15, and John 16, this is all Jesus having a conversation with the disciples before he goes. And in these three chapters, he's having a conversation specifically about asking. About asking. Watch this. Oh, my gosh. Glory to God. Let's look at John 14 then. 14, 13 through 14. The Bible says in John 14, verse 13 through 14, it says, watch this, because this is Jesus at the Last Supper talking to the disciples. He's telling them, he says, whatever you ask in my name that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Glory to God. Glory to God. That's what Jesus told them at the Last Supper in the upper room. Now, I heard about three claps on that, so maybe y'all didn't get it. Let me give you some more upper room conversation. Let's go to John 16, 23. Mr. Burst, they didn't get it because I got about three claps on that from that upper room conversation when Jesus says, ask, I'll do it. Look what Jesus says in John 16 now. He's still talking to them in the upper room. He's still talking to them at the Last Supper. Look what he says in John 16, verse 23 through 24. John 16, verse 23 through 24. Jesus says, and in that day, you'll ask me for nothing. Most assuredly, I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. Watch this. It says, until now, you have not asked me nothing. You haven't asked nothing in my name. He says, but ask and you will receive, and your joy may be filled. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. This is Jesus, Angie, saying, I don't know what you're sitting over there with your lips so tight for. Talk to me about it. I don't know what you're complaining about the bread notice. Talk to me about it. I don't know why you're sitting over there mad at your son acting crazy. Talk to me about it. I don't know why you're sitting over there like you're so tired. Talk to me about it. I don't know why you're over there worried about what the doctor said. Talk to me about it. My grandmama used to say, a closed mouth cannot be fed. Jesus said, ask and you will receive, that your joy may be filled. That brings me to point number one. Point number one, prayer is petition. Prayer is petition, asking. Prayer is petition, asking. Sure, God wants us to ask, and the Bible says he will give us what we ask in Jesus' name. But I need you to notice that when Jesus was teaching us the Lord's Prayer, before he went to the part of petition, David, he gave us a filter. Because when Jesus says, I want y'all to pray like this, remember I told you, praise, petition, praise. But look what Jesus said in the Lord's Prayer. Because before Jesus took us to the petition part of the Lord's Prayer, he said, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. You remember last week when we discussed about how when we focus on Jesus, when Jesus is the king of our life, he places his desires in us and it becomes his will, not ours. The Bible says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. What was Jesus saying? Jesus saying, yeah, I want you to ask, but you got to run it through this filter. Mm-hmm. What filter, Pastor? The filter of God's will. He said, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Now ask. Oh, my gosh. You see, now, watch this. Now when we begin to pray through that filter, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So now you're praying according to his will. Now you're praying according to his will. So how do I do that, preacher? That sounds pretty big, pretty global. Pray to God's will. Pray through God's will. How do I do that? I'm glad y'all asked. Glory be to God. You pray according to his word. You pray according to his word, because his word is his will for our life. God might not answer everything you say, Jay, but the Bible says in Isaiah 55:11 that he always has to answer his word, because the Bible says, my word shall never return void. Hey, we have to pray God's word according to our life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Prayer is not a bunch of random words. Your prayer should be, Lord, I believe your word, your promises for my life, and I'm ready to receive it. Let me say it again. Prayer should not be a bunch of words. Prayer should be, Lord, I believe your word, your promises for my life, and I'm ready to receive it. I need you to understand something about prayer. It's not how long you pray, it's how quick you believe. That's so good right there. It's not how long you pray, it's how quick you believe. Mm-hmm. Watch this. Watch this. Now, of course, God can change our circumstances. You heard the worship team. You heard my worship leader. We serve a God of miracles. And yes, we do. God can change our situations because God is a miracle-working God. But I want to share with you another huge miracle of prayer. A huge miracle of prayer is that in prayer, God not only changes your circumstances, watch this, but God changes us. A huge miracle in prayer is that God changes us. Watch this. Our perspectives change. Our vantage point change. The promises we grab hold of change. The choices that we make change. We begin to see ourselves clearer in prayer. So then we begin to face our circumstances differently. Our struggle may not change right away. But we change because our hearts become different when we commune with God. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me show you a conversation, another conversation that Jesus had about prayer. Let's go to Luke chapter 18, verse 8, verse 1 through 8. Luke chapter 18, verse 1 through 8. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 18, verse 1 through 8. Take us to our second point. The Bible says, then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray. Watch this. And not give up. Always pray. And not give up. I was talking to the first service, and I said, we need to get a pit bull type of prayer. You know, the Bible says they ought to pray and not give up. Jacob said, I grab hold to you, Jesus, and I won't let you go until you bless me. I don't know if you know anything about a pit bull, but when you lock on to something, you're going to have to kill him to let it go. We got to get a pit bull type of prayer. I'm healed. I'm delivered. I'm set free. I'm the child of the Most High God. Hey, we got to grab hold to the word of God like a pit bull and not let go. The problem is we got too many poodles and not enough pit bulls. Hey, I feel the Holy Ghost. The Bible says, then Jesus told the disciples, always pray and never give up. Then Jesus told his disciples a parable, always pray and never give up. He said, in a certain town, there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared what people thought. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with a plea. Grant me justice against my adversary. For some time he refused. But finally he said to himself, even though I don't fear God or care what people think, yet because Silo keep bothering me, yet because Ian keep bothering me, yet because Eric keeps bothering me, yet because Chris just won't leave me alone. Anybody in the house just won't leave Jesus alone. He says, because this widow keeps bothering me. I feel the Holy Ghost. Because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice so that she won't eventually come and attack me. And then Jesus said, listen to what the unjust judge says. He says, and will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him, watch this, day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, Jesus said, I tell you, he will see that y'all get justice, watch this, woman of God, and quickly. I like what he said, and quickly. You see, he says, Jesus says, come to me, and I'm going to make sure you get justice, and quickly. He says, but however, when the Son of Man comes, when Jesus comes, Will he find faith like that on earth? So I'm going to ask y'all again, when Jesus comes, is he going to find poodles or is he going to find pit bulls? Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Now, this is Jesus with this story, again, teaching us about prayer. How many of you know prayer is spiritual warfare? Prayer is spiritual warfare. Watch this. Prayer is confrontation with the enemy. Prayer is confrontation with the enemy. That brings me to point number two. Point number two, prayer is conflict resolution. Point number two, prayer is conflict resolution. Mm-hmm. Now, Jesus is saying something with the people. He's talking to the disciples in this story, and he's telling the disciples, first of all, there was a judge. And this judge in the story was a picture of, watch this, he's a picture of the power and authority of God. In this story, that the widow kept bugging the judge until he answered her prayer with justice and quickness, you got to understand, when Jesus told this story, the judge, with all power and authority, represented God. Watch this. God is the only real authority in the world we live in today. Now notice this. Notice this. This woman brings her complaint to the judge, Jay. But watch this. She brought her complaint not only to the judge, but he brought it to the judge first. You see, he brought it to the judge first. Often we treat prayer like the last response, like the last result and not the first response. Too often we treat prayer like it's the last result and not the first response. Let me talk to some people that used to be Catholic. I see about 15 of y'all. Okay, watch this. Glory to God. That's a good thing, though, because now you know the truth. You know, sometimes you got to come from a place that wasn't the right, kind of right. And when you get to when it's really right, then it explodes in you. Well, prayer, some people treat prayer like it's a Hail Mary. You know, in football, a Hail Mary, you know, football is, come on, y'all know. Football, when there ain't no other chance, ain't no other downs, you have no other plays, and you just throw the ball up and hope somebody catch it. Some of us pray like that. That's a Hail Mary. You see, when Hail Mary first came into existence, Zach, it came into existence from Gabriel talking to Mary. Gabriel said, "Hail Mary, you have been found highly favored." And the Catholics made it a song, you know, a prayer. Hail Mary, they made it a prayer. Listen to me, but what I want to talk to us about is our effort in prayer. We got to stop treating prayer like a last-ditch effort, just throwing something up in the air and hoping it comes out good. Come on, somebody. We got to start treating prayer like this.
Yeah. Come on. Come on.
That's prayer. Come on, somebody. Some of us are treating prayer like a Hail Mary, and I'm trying to get us blessed today. Hallelujah. 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 This woman went to the judge first and often because the judge had all authority. Let me show you what the Bible says. Because the woman went to the judge because she knew the judge had all power and all authority. So she went to the judge first. The judge represents Jesus. Let me show you why. The Bible says in Matthew 28:18, Jesus came, and this is what he said. This is Jesus telling the disciples, "Hey, y'all, all authority is mine from heaven and earth." That's what Jesus said. Jesus told the disciples, "Listen up, all authority belongs to me on heaven and in earth." Now, he happened to delegate it to us, but Jesus says, "I want the world to know. I don't know what you're looking at. I don't know what you heard. I don't know what your neighbor said. I don't know what your coworker said. But this one thing I do know. I, Jesus, have all authority and all power. Watch this. Watch this. Here's my question. So, how much authority does Jesus have? See, I heard about four people. This ain't a trick question. Let me try it again. Let me try it again, Zach. So, how much authority does Jesus have? Well, right. If Jesus has all authority, then how much authority do you think cancer has? You getting it? So then, if Jesus has all authority, then how much authority does depression have? So if Jesus has all authority, then how much authority does past hurt in your past have? Come on, somebody. Now we're getting it. Oh, I love a church that'll talk back. If Jesus has all authority, then his authority is greater than anything we might face. Shakira, can I talk to you for a minute? Be all right. We good? We good like that now? So the problem these people have is Shakira, not me and you, but the problem these people have is Shakira, watch this. The problem they have is Shakira is that they struggling. Shakira, can you see me? They struggling when they face issues. And they got the power. Well, why am I struggling? I got Jesus. Jesus? Jesus. What's going on, Shakira? I mean, come on. All authority is in his hand. I got him. Why am I not seeing power? Because you got to plug him in. You see that, Shakira? See, the problem is we don't have no power because we ain't plugged in to Jesus. How do I get plugged in? With prayer. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to help us. Hallelujah. 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 Now, Jesus said this. Jesus says a widow came to the judge. A widow came to the judge. Now, it's important that you notice, Tony, that Jesus didn't say woman. Because most of the time when Jesus is talking about a miracle, he says this woman. But there are a few times Jesus uses widow. But whenever you see Jesus using widow, it represents the church and the scenario he's trying to deliver us from. Because widow represents someone who has lost something. Widow represents somebody who has got something stolen from them. You see, when Jesus talks about the widow, he's really talking about the church. Because the widow represents somebody who lost something. Somebody the devil has took something from. So Jesus says, here's this widow going to the judge, and the widow represents you and I. You see, the adversary had stolen something from her. Watch this. If we would be real in here today, if we would just be 100 real, the enemy has stolen something from all of us before. Maybe he stole your joy. Maybe he stole your time. Maybe he stole your relationship. Maybe he stole your edge. You know, come on, somebody. I mean, if we'll be real. But Jesus, with this story, is challenging us that when the adversary shows up like a roaring lion seeking who he should destroy, that we should plug in to Jesus even more and first through prayer. Because prayer is conflict resolution. Prayer is conflict resolution. Let me show you something else to solidify this widow thing. And prayer. Let's look at 1 Timothy chapter 5. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 5. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 5. Look at what the Bible says. The widow who is really in need. Remember what I told you. The widow means somebody who lost something, somebody something stole, somebody in need. That's the church. The widow who is really in need and left all alone, watch this, puts her hope in God and continues, here we go, night and day to pray and ask God for help. Come on, somebody. Seek Jesus day and night. Now, Jesus says there is a judge who represents God in all his authority and power. And then Jesus says in his story to the disciples about prayer, he says, there is a widow. And the widow represents you and I, us in need. But then Jesus says in his story that there is an adversary. There is an adversary. Now, the adversary is Satan. I need you to understand something. There is animosity between you and Satan. There's animosity between the devil and the believer. Come on, somebody. This is spiritual warfare. But Jesus says, keep coming to him in prayer first, often, and day and night. Come on. He says, and you will see to it. Watch this. Jesus says, if you keep coming to him in prayer first, often, day and night, Jesus says, I'll see to it that you get justice and get justice quickly over the adversary. You see, the adversary wants to block God's very best for us. So that you see, he will attack our mind. Come on, somebody. He'll attack our body. He will attack our relationships. He'll attack our material needs. But Jesus says, you have an advocate with me, and I will bring you conflict resolution quickly, but you got to pray. No. Let me help us. Let me help us for a minute. Us. Me too. Me too, Ian. I promise you, me too. Oftentimes, we think our biggest battle is with people. Oftentimes we think our biggest battle is with people, so we end up responding badly to people, allowing people to push our buttons, so then we act in a way that does not bring God glory. Come on, somebody. Am I the only one? Am I the only one? Am I the only one that starts looking at people saying, if you don't shut up right now? Oftentimes we think our biggest battle is with people, so we end up responding badly to people, allowing people to push our buttons, so we act in a way that does not bring glory to God. When really it's the adversary, Satan, behind the people guiding the conflict. Really it's Satan behind the people guiding the conflict. Let me show you what the Bible says. Let me prove it to you. Let's go to Ephesians 6, chapter 12. Ephesians 6, chapter 12. Look what the Bible says. The Bible says you don't wrestle against people. It says you wrestle against flesh. You don't wrestle against flesh and blood, people. You wrestle against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of the age, against spiritual wicked hosts. Spiritual wicked hosts. Spiritual, watch this. Sometimes when people get in your face with that frivolous flapping, that yada, 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 yada. The problem is we start looking at them and we clap back. And then the situation doesn't give God glory. He doesn't get involved. There's no power. There's no advancement. It ain't even solved. It's just put on the table to happen another day. If not with that person, somebody else. But I wonder what would happen when the enemy starts pushing people towards you, when the enemy gets behind people and starts guiding them in conflict, and they get in your face with frivolous flapping, talking about yada, 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 yada. And you just start saying, Get behind me, Satan. They'll start. They'll just start running. You just start glorifying God in the middle of their face. Hey, Jesus. Hey, Jesus. You'd be like, what's wrong with you? Don't you know you're at Costco's? No, no, no. I'm standing on holy ground. You think I'm at Costco's, but I'm in holy ground. Saying, hey, Jesus. Hey, Jesus. Hey, Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to help us. It's not with people. Jesus is saying, them people ain't the problem, but it's the devil behind them guiding them. Then he says, watch this. Right after Jesus went through that, telling us that the problem is not physical. It's a spiritual thing working. Most of the time when you see people ugly on the outside, it's because something ugly is happening on the inside. It's a wicked spiritual battle. Jesus is saying it ain't the people. It's the devil behind them guiding them. But then Jesus went on to say in the same chapter, he says, but now, because it's a spiritual war, when he went on, Andrew, to say, it's not flesh and blood. It's the devil. He says, so I'm going to need you to put on your armor. Y'all remember the scripture, armor of God. If you've ever been to Sunday school, you know you learned two things, Shayla, in Church of God in Christ. You know we had two stories down pat, the armor of God and David and Goliath. We knew them by heart. So listen, Jesus is saying after he told the disciples, look, y'all ain't battling with people. This is a spiritual warfare. He said to them, but put on the armor of God. So what's the armor of God? Come on, we know it. The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, the shoes of peace, the sword of the Spirit, and the shield of faith, right? So Jesus told them, put on the armor. But after Jesus mentions each piece of the armor one time, let me show you what else he said. After Jesus told him this is a spiritual battle and he mentioned each piece of the armor one time, he continued to talk to them about the spiritual battle. And this is what he said. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18 through 20. This is Jesus still in the same conversation. Look what he says. Now, after I told you, this is not your neighbor. This is not your roommate. That's the devil. Go into the spirit. Jesus says, now, it ain't the devil. I mean, it ain't your neighbor. It's the devil. So put on the full armor of God. But now watch this once you get your armor on. Because most of us get the armor on and we run out the door. But we missed it. Because look what he said. He says, right after you put on the armor, he says, and pray in the spirit. That means it's important to have a prayer language. He says, pray in the spirit. But watch this. Watch this. He says, pray in the spirit on all occasions. But then he says, with all kinds of prayer. And that's good because some of us may not have a prayer language. And stop telling people they're not going to heaven because they don't speak in tongues. That's not true. Right. Now, I hope that we all do, but that's not true. Because the Bible says right here, if you don't have a prayer language, go and pray how you pray. He says, pray with all kind of prayers, too, right? Then he went on to say, he says, and request. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying, three times, for all the Lord's people. Pray for the church. Then he says, watch this, four. Pray for me also. Now he's telling them, pray for your pastor. He says, pray for me also that whatever I speak, words may be given so that I will be fearless in making known the mysteries of the gospel. You got to be praying for your pastor that he could get behind the word and give it to us and unveil some things that would give us power in this life. He says, number four, pray so the pastor will be able to speak to you about the mysteries of the gospel. Then it says, watch this, for which I am ambassador in chains. Watch this, five. Pray that I may declare fearlessly as I should. Now, wait a minute. Jesus said it's a spiritual battle, and he mentioned armor one time, but he mentioned prayer five times. Come on, somebody. He mentioned prayer five times. Why did he mention prayer five times? You see, he mentioned prayer five times because prayer is the real weapon. Hey, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing, Pastor. What's my motivation for praying without ceasing? Well, I know that God has all authority. I know who I am in Christ. I know the plans he has for me. I know what I am supposed to have. Wait, let me tell them again, Shakira, because I don't care. This is why I pray without ceasing. This is my motivation, not because the pastor said it, not because I'm holy, holy, muchy, much, such and such, not because I want the people to hear me. I'm praying, and I ain't stopped praying. Hey, Shakira, I'm praying, and I ain't stopped praying because I'm accessing what I know. I know that Jesus has all authority. I don't stop praying because I'm accessing what I know. I know I am a child of the Most High God. I don't stop praying because I'm accessing what I know. I know who I am in Christ. I don't stop praying because I know the plans he has for me. I don't stop praying because I know what I'm supposed to have. I don't stop praying because I know what the word says about me. Whew. Now, after all of this, after all of that, Fred, you know, prayer is petition. Prayer is conflict resolution. After all of this, there's a doxology that needs to take place. There's a doxology that needs to take place. Hey, I remember when I was in seminary school and they began to teach us about doxology, Nate. They said this word is made of two Greek words. He says doxy means praise. He says in the Greek, logos means expression, but you know, in Hebrew, logos means word, but in the Greek, logos means expression. So doxology is an expression of praise. That brings me to point number three. Point number three, prayer is praise. Prayer is praise. Prayer is praise. Now listen, I'm not talking about emotionalism. Emotionalism is when you get excited and nothing happens. But it is a legitimate emotion where you are responding to someone for what they have done. It is a legitimate emotion that you are responding to Jesus for what he has done. When you understand what kind of name Jesus has, it ought to be hollow. The Bible says, hollow be his name. That's praise. When you understand, oh, glory be to God. When you understand the perfect will to be carried out for his purpose, it ought to be praised. When you understand that nothing you have could come to you if it wasn't for the source, your praise for him ought to be for daily bread. When you really understand what it means to be forgiven and to be a forgiver, you ought to praise. When you really understand how bad Satan was trying to get you, but God led you out so you wouldn't be run over by Satan, you ought to praise. So if you understand all of that I have said, you ought to have a doxology response. There ought to be praise welling up in your soul. At the end of the Lord's Prayer, Jesus said this. This was his doxology. At the end of his prayer, Jesus was teaching about prayer, and he went into a praise expression. This was his doxology. Jesus, at the end of the Lord's Prayer, he says, thine is the kingdom, thine is the power, and thine is the glory. Jesus says, pray like this. In light of what you've learned God will do in the Lord's Prayer, Jesus says, I need you to praise because of that. Because Jesus, watch this. Jesus would have never told us in the Lord's Prayer to ask for daily bread. Jesus would have never told us to ask for forgiveness. Jesus would have never told us to ask for direction. Jesus would have never told us to ask for protection if the Lord was not prepared to give it to us. Come on. Jesus says, thine is the kingdom. That means it's about the king. Is your prayer about you, or is it about who the king is? Is your prayer about who you are, or is your prayer about who the king is? Come on. 1 Corinthians says in 2:26 that earth and heaven belongs to God. The reason it is critical that Jesus be king in our life is because if he's allowed to rule, he will control your outcome. If Jesus is king and he's allowed to rule your life, he will control your outcome. When you get out of your bed in the morning, I'm going to get on somebody's street right now. When you roll out of bed in the morning, it shouldn't be your coffee. When you roll out of bed in the morning, the first thing shouldn't be your juice. When you roll out of bed in the morning, the first thing shouldn't be your cell phone. When you roll out of the bed in the morning, the first thing needs to come out of your mouth is, Jesus, I will allow you to rule today. Jesus, you can control my outcome. When you get out of bed in the morning, Shakira, you ought to be submitting to God's authority, saying, God, I'm up. My way gonna be your way today. Hey, God, I'm up. My way gonna be your way today. Come on, somebody. Thine, hey, is the power. Oh, watch this, watch this. When you submit to God's authority, your way will be his way. Then God went on to say, Jesus went on to say, thine is the power. You see, you will see God's power in your life when you're subjected to the kingdom. You'll see God's power in your life when you're subjected to the kingdom. Give me 5 minutes, we're done. So I was telling Frank at first service, because I said that when you subject to the authority of God, you see power. You see, you can be gifted and not anointed. Yeah. You could be gifted and anointed and have no power. You see, watch this. We all got gifts. We come out of the womb with them because God has given us all a gift. But until we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we're not anointed. Because when Jesus comes on the inside of us, that is the anointed one on the inside of me and you, we become anointed. Well, we already had a gift. He already knew you were supposed to be a fireman because he knew how you cared about people. That was a gift. But then you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Now you became an anointed fireman. But you can be an anointed fireman with no power. Because if Jesus said to you, you need to be a fireman in Prescott, stay right here, and you said, well, Flagstaff is paying me $3,000 more. I'm going to Flagstaff. Well, you'll be in Flagstaff, you'll be anointed. You'll be gifted because God can't repent his gift. He can't take back his gift. And if you're saved and Jesus lives on the inside of you, newsflash, you can't be unsaved. So now, no matter where I go, I'm still gifted, I'm still anointed. But because I'm in Flagstaff and God says stay in Prescott, now I'm gifted and I'm anointed, but there's no power. But the minute I get back to Prescott where God said go, now I am gifted, I am anointed, and I got power. Why do I have power? Because I have surrendered to the authority of God. And when I surrender to the authority of God, when I surrender in regrouping, God puts his super on my natural. When I surrender to God's authority, he begins to work his power through me. When I surrender to my regrouping, God says, I'm searching the earth to and from to show who I can put my power on. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles 16:9, it says, I'm searching the earth to share my power with him who will be loyal to me. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Then praise says, then the doxicology of Jesus says, thine is the kingdom. Thine is the power. Then Jesus says, thine is the glory. Come on, somebody. He says, thine is the glory. You see, when we heard that thine is the glory, we thought it was just like something Jesus do, probably shine a light in the dark. And you see, that's glory. No, that's not what I'm talking about. Jesus is the glory. Thine is the glory. The Bible says in Psalms 115:1 that my name is glory. Jesus says my name is glory. And because my name is glory, the reason why my name is glory is because I am love. I am faithfulness. Some of us might show some love. Some of us might be faithful. But God said, ain't no doing. I am. I am the I am. I am the I am. Jesus says, I am glory because I am love, because I am faithful. I want to tell y'all today, if we're going to live life on another level, if we're going to live life on another level, we're going to have to pray. And if we're going to pray, our prayer should be petition. Our prayer should be conflict resolution. Our prayer should be praise. If we gonna live life on another level, if we going up, moving on up, if we gonna move up, then we gonna have to have prayer. Hey, petition. We gonna have to have prayer. Conflict resolution. Hey, if we gonna move up, we gotta have prayer. Praise. I wanna tell somebody today, when I call on the name Jesus, hey, I said, when I call on the name Jesus, oh, when I call on the name Jesus. Now, I got to be honest with you, because that's the time. Wait, watch this. Get up, Tyler. Get up. Mr. Burke, would you get up? Mrs. Burke, would you get up, please? I need y'all to stand in line right here. Come on, Nate, get in line with him. You see, it's form a line right there. You see, there are often times when I try to take care of my situation on my own. There are times when I try to take care of my situation on my own, and I can't get through. I can't break through. There's no breakthrough on my own. But when I call on the name Jesus, the Bible says, not by my might, not by my power, but by his spirit, when I call on the name Jesus, God sends a heavenly host. When I call on the name Jesus, God sends a heavenly host. How do you know, preacher? Because the Bible says in Luke chapter 2, God was giving us a principle very early. He says in Luke chapter 2, they found Jesus in a manger. The Bible says Jesus was in a manger. And when he put him in a manger, the Bible says, here comes a heavenly host. What was Jesus doing? He was letting us know, when you call on the name Jesus, I'll send a heavenly host. Or when you call on the name Jesus, I'll send a heavenly host. Watch this. When I call on the name Jesus, get up here. Come here, Chris. Come here. Watch this. When I call on the name Jesus, God sends the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Hey, when I call on the name Jesus, God sends a heavenly host. He sends the Father. He sends the Holy Ghost. He sends the Son. Watch this. When I call on the name Jesus, come here, man. God sends not only does he send the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. When I call on the name Jesus, he sends mercy and grace. Watch it. Now I got five people, David, because God says, when you call on the name Jesus, how do I know that, mother? Because the Bible says in Psalms 91 that when I dwell in the Most High, that means calling on the name Jesus. When I call on the name Jesus, God sends a heavenly host. So he sends the Father. Mm-hmm. So he sends the Son. Mm-hmm. So he sends the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. And he sends goodness and mercy. But the Bible says, when I call on the name Jesus, come here, Amanda. He sends angels. The Bible says angels are assigned to my life. Now watch this. I don't know if y'all can count as good as I can, but this is six people plus me, that's seven. Now seven is a heavenly host, mother. Seven is a heavenly host, because seven is a number of completion. So when I call on the name Jesus, God sends the Father, God sends the Holy Ghost, God sends the Son, God sends mercy, God sends grace, God sends angels. And then I got me. Come on, surround me. Come on, surround me. Then me and the heavenly host, we go this way. We go this way. And we just get through and we got breakthrough. We got breakthrough in the name of Jesus. 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 Hey, hey, hey. When I call on the name Jesus, watch this. I'm getting ready to close. I feel like having church. I feel the Holy Ghost. When I call on the name Jesus, watch this. When I call on the name Jesus, the Bible says in Psalms 91, when I call on the name Jesus, the Bible says in Psalms 91, God will send angels. When I call on the name Jesus, the Bible says in Psalms 91 that God will defend me. The Bible says in Psalms 91, when I call on the name Jesus, that God will protect me from harm and disaster. The Bible says, when I call on the name Jesus, when I call on the name Jesus, the Bible says God will lift up my hands. Psalms 91 says, when I call on the name Jesus, oh my gosh, when I call on the name Jesus, the Bible says God will keep me from trouble. The Bible says, when I call on the name Jesus, God will keep my feet from stumbling. Oh my gosh, I'm talking about the Bible. The Bible says in Psalms 91, when I call on the name Jesus, oh my gosh, when I call on the name Jesus, the Bible says, watch this, God will allow me to walk on top of lions and serpents. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Where they at? I can't see them because they're under my feet. Jesus, Jesus, when I call on the name Jesus, the Bible says I will walk on top of lions. I'll walk on top of serpents. Wait a minute. The Bible says, when I call on the name Jesus, in Psalms 91, the Bible says God will deliver me. God will honor me, and I shall have long life. When I call on the name Jesus, the name Jesus, the name Jesus. Oh, I feel like having church. The name Jesus. 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 Oh, oh. Oh, let's ask the church. Let's ask the church. The Bible says, strength. When the righteous cry out, I'll hear them and deliver them in the name of Jesus. The Bible says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but I shall deliver them from them all. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, wait a minute. I feel like having church. The Bible says, if you knock, I'll answer. If you seek, you shall find. When I call on the name Jesus. Woo! Give God glory in this place. Hallelujah. Woo! My, my, my. Oh, oh, shadadabasitanaboko. I feel the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. 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 Listen, prayer is calling on the name Jesus. I remember my mama couldn't remember nothing to say. She just say, Lordy, Lordy, Lordy. Sometimes you ain't got a bunch of fancy words. You just got to call on Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And you know what? Jesus started pulling on God's coat. Said, Daddy, don't you hear David calling my name? He said, yeah, I heard him. He said, well, what you want me to do? He said, get some of them people and go down there and see about it. take that heavenly host down there. And all of a sudden, right in the middle of your job, right in the middle of Safeway, right in the mechanic shop, when the mechanic is acting like a butthead, you just start praying. Like, I don't know who you are right now, and you really don't know who I am. Because my Bible says, touch not my anointed, and do my prophet no harm. Hey, I start calling on the, oh, I feel like, hey, I don't want to go home. I start calling on the name Jesus, 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 Jesus. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. I feel the Holy Ghost. When I start talking about Jesus, I start remembering all that he's done for me. And my soul shouts hallelujah. Oh, my God. If you know like I know, all we need is Jesus. We're going to live life on another level. And they're going to start asking us, why is your joy overflow? Why is your finances overflow? Why are you so healthy? Why are you so beautiful? Why are you so smart? Why do you got so much peace? Why do you have so much peace? You're going to say, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And they're going to know we're living life on another level. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Give God glory. Woo. I don't know. Ian, we better bring up the ushers before we lose all our people. We're going too late. We better bring up the ushers. We don't want to lose all our people for being late. Look up and just be me and you in here. Because we know what Jesus has done for me and you. Everybody can leave. Me and you better still be there. Like, you're right, sir. I thank you. I was that. You did that. I lost that. You gave it back. I thank you, sir. Woo! Glory to God. Let me tell you what happened at first service. See how Holy Ghost work. So my keyboard player works a job, right? My keyboard player works a job. I'm telling you real stories. This is not TB and Tony. This is us happening in our church. My keyboard player, works a job, and he has to work on Sundays. So he can only participate in worship before service. And then he has to run out, jump in his car, and fly to work without getting a ticket. Because he got to be at work by 12:30, right? Well, today his boss came to first service. His boss was in church. Don't tell me about what Jesus won't do. So his boss was in church. And when church was over, Mr. Birch, his boss came running to me. And he says, God just told me, you can have Frank at second service. Leave him there. Now I'm telling you about Jesus. Because I had told Frank, it's time to move in the Holy Ghost now. And he said, I got something for us, Bishop. His boss came running out of nowhere and said, look, sir, you can have Frank all service. He don't have to be at work today. There's power in that name. Can I show y'all that? I don't even know if I can. Can I show y'all a scripture about giving so we try to get out of here? Because I feel like the revival just might break out right now. And we're going to be late for dinner when the Shekinah glory show up. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to be late for Phoenix when the Shekinah glory show up. Yeah, we will. Yeah, we will. It ain't going to be weird, man. But I tell you, when the Shekinah glory show up, we ain't going to be able to get out of here. You're going to be like, I'm trying to get up. What is this? Watch this scripture about giving, because I want to teach Bible when it comes to giving, because we don't beg in Mount Zion. If I got to beg, I'm going to come work with you. Turn around, look at this scripture, y'all. Let's look at it. Look at what the scripture says about giving. The Bible says, therefore, by him, Jesus, let us continue to offer a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks. Now watch this. That ain't all. Then watch what he said, giving the fruit of his lips to his name. He says, but don't forget to do good and to share. Jesus is saying, I heard what you said, but make it applicable in your life. He says, I hear you praising my name, but I need to watch what you do. He says, don't forget, though, after you praise with your mouth, don't forget to do good. And he says, don't forget to share, for with such a sacrifice like that, he says, that I'm well pleased. God says, I'm well pleased. God says, I'm well pleased. That's the Bible. That's the Bible. Hey, it's time to give, Mount Zion. We're going to worship our way out in the Holy Ghost today, I guarantee you. Take us in the Holy Ghost, Frank. Just move on whatever God is putting on your heart.
Oh, come to the altar. Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus.
If you know it, sing along with us.
Oh, come to the altar.
Yes.
The Father's arms
are open. Let heaven hear you. Let heaven hear you.
Wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus. Woo. You're perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways.
If you love Jesus today, worship with him. Let's worship
you're
our way out.
You're perfect in all of your ways. To
love Jesus, come on. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, you're perfect in all of your ways.
Come on.
Yes, you are perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways. To us. Yes, you're a good, good father. That's who you are. That's
Come
who
on.
You are.
Come on.
Oh,
if this was your last day on earth, how would you
want to
have church?
And I'm led by you. That's who I am. That's who I am. Oh, you're a good, good father. That's who you are. That's who you are. Oh,
come on. Let's worship. Come on, mother.
Who I am.
Yeah.
That's who I am.
Come on, y'all.
That's who I am.
If we're going to be a little late for church, let's be late in the presence of the Lord. Let's let the Holy Ghost move on us for a minute.
Perfect
this Holy Ghost church.
Come
on, come on, come on.
Perfect in all of your ways to us. You're perfect, Jesus. You're perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways.
Yeah.
You're perfect in all of your ways to us.
There's anybody that needs another touch from the Lord, come on now. Come on if that's you. Come on to the altar if you need another touch from the Lord. The power of the Holy Ghost is in the altar right now. Come on. If there's anybody in here who does not know Jesus, come now. Come now. Come now. If you want to rededicate your life to Jesus, please come now. Come on, God. This is the day. There's power in the altar today. This is the Holy Ghost. This is the Holy Ghost church. Jesus is in this house. There's power in this altar. I don't know what you need, but if you need another touch from Jesus, come now.
Come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with
Come on, Mary.
The precious blood of Jesus
Christ. Come on, Mary. Come on.
Oh, what a
Savior.
Is he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Stretch your hands out to these. Just ask God to move mightily in their lives. Move, God, please. Move.
For he is Lord.
Thank you, Holy
Ghost.
Thank you, Jesus.
Sing hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar. Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, yes, you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you're a good
Father. Fall in love with Jesus.
It's who you are.
Take him out
of
here.
It's who you are. It's who you are. I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Hallelujah.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love,
yes, Lord,
with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus is the best thing I've ever done.
Father God, we pray right now in Jesus' precious name. Father, that you would manifest your presence in our prayer life. Lord, that you would show up in our petition. Lord, that you would show up in our resolution conflict. Lord, that you would show up in our praise. Father, we need you. God, I'm asking that you show up in our prayer closet. Father, that you show up in our fasting time. Father, that you show up in our consecrated time. Father, we need you. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, you said if we seek you first in your righteousness, that you would add all things to us. Father, today I'm asking that you add a blessing unto these. Father, that you add power unto these. Father, that you add healing unto these. Father, that you add prosperity unto these. Father, that you add deliverance unto these. Father, that you add manifest joy unto these. Father, that you add peace unto these. Father, according to your word, I pray in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Whoa.
That's how you have church. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Falling in Jesus.